Welcome to the 21st meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The only item on our public agenda today is to consider the Aggregates Tax and Devolved Taxes Administration Scotland Bill at Stage 2. We are joined today by Ivan McKee, Minister for Public Finance. The Minister is accompanied by Scottish Government officials. Although the officials will be present for this session, they are unable to participate in formal Stage 2 proceedings under standing orders. I'll briefly explain the procedure we'll be following during today's proceedings for anyone watching. Members should have with them a copy of the bill, marshalled list and the groupings, which are also available on the Scottish Parliament's website. I will call each amendment individually in the order of the marshalled list. The member who lodged the amendment should either move it or say not moved when it is called. If that member doesn't move it, any other member present may do so. The groupings of amendments sets out the amendments in the order in which they will be debated. There will be one debate on each group of amendments. In each debate, I will call a member who lodged the first amendment in the group to speak to and move that amendment and to speak to all the other amendments in the group. I will then call other members with amendments in the group to speak to, but not to move, their amendments and to speak to other amendments in the group if they wish. I will then call any other members who wish to speak in the debate. Members wishing to speak should indicate that by catching my attention or that of the clerks. I'll then call the minister if he's not already spoken in the debate. Finally, I'll call the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up and to indicate whether he or she wishes to press the amendment or to withdraw it. If the amendment is pressed, I'll put the question on the amendment. If a member wishes to withdraw an amendment after it has been moved and debated, I'll ask whether any member present objects. If there's an objection, I'll immediately put the question on the amendment. Later amendments in a group are not debated again when they're reached. If they're moved, I'll put the question on them straight away. If there's a division, only committee members are entitled to vote. Voting is by a show of hands. It's important that members keep their hands raised clearly until clerk has recorded their names. The committee is also required to consider and decide on each section and schedule of the bill and the long title. I'll put the question on each of these provisions at the appropriate point. We will now begin Stage 2 proceedings. I'm sure that's clear, everyone watching. Okay. So, I call Amendment 1 in the name of... Well, first of all, I'd like to ask if sections 1 to 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes,
yes, we are all agreed. I call Amendment 1 in the name of the Minister. Group to the Amendments 2, 3, 4 and 5. Minister, I move Amendment 1 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Convener and Committee. I move Amendment 1 and urge members to support my amendments in this group. As noted in the evidence given to committee and throughout the Stage 1 debate, stakeholders have consistently raised concerns about unauthorised, untaxed aggregate. Section 8.5 of the bill provides that where there is a supply chain arising from an agreement to supply taxable aggregate, every person in the chain is liable to pay the total amount of tax chargeable on the aggregate as a result of the agreement. This will not apply to those who have acquired the aggregate from a supplier who is registered for tax under Section 17 of the Bill. The purpose of this section of the Bill is to reduce tax avoidance by encouraging the purchasing of taxable aggregate from registered producers. The amendments in this group are intended to provide certainty about the application of this provision and reduce the potential for future disputes. Amendments 1 to 3 confirm that the agreement referred to in Section 8.5 is the original agreement to supply between producer and customer, and that any subsequent agreements to supply the same aggregate form part of one chain of supply. This is intended to prevent disputes about what constitutes a chain of supply. Amendment 4 is intended to confirm that the relevant time at which a supplier's registration status should be considered is the point at which aggregate is acquired. This is to ensure that liability includes a scenario where aggregate is acquired from someone who only registered for the tax at a later date. Finally, Section 18 of the Bill requires those who carry out taxable activities to register for Scottish aggregates tax. Amendment 5 changes Section 18.4, which obliges Revenue Scotland to register such persons whether or not they have notified Revenue Scotland, from a requirement on Revenue Scotland to register such persons to a discretionary power to do so. This amendment has been informed by further engagement with Revenue Scotland and is intended to provide the revenue authorities with operational flexibility to focus compliant activities where it's most effective in a chain of supply. Thank you.
Thank you. No members have indicated... Oh, sorry, Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Sorry for indicating late there because it was just on the Minister's final few lines there. Just looking for a bit of clarity on Amendments 1 to 4, I think all make complete sense. I was wondering if the Minister could explain what scenarios in which Revenue Scotland would not want to exercise that operational power. Why move from must to may? What are the situations in which they wouldn't want to do so?
This was, again, something that Revenue Scotland highlighted. As I understand it, their concern is that if there is a chain of supply with a number of parties in it, they want the ability to be able to identify where they're most likely to recover the tax from. So they may look at that and decide if we target this particular link in the chain, that's the most effective way of doing it, rather than being compelled to address every link in the chain when they find that that might not be the most effective use of the resource to cover the tax due.
Thanks.
Okay. No other colleagues have indicated they wish to come in. Minister, to wind up.
No further comment, Convener.
Okay, thank you. The question is, Amendment 1 be agreed to? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendments 2, 3 and 4, all in the name of the Minister, and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 2 to 4 on block.
Moved.
Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 2 to 4? No members object. The question is that Amendments 2 to 4 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that Section 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that Sections 9 to 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 5 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that Sections 19 to 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 6 in the name of the Minister, group with Amendments 7 and 13. Minister, to move Amendment 6 and speak to all amendments in the group. Minister.
Convener, I move Amendment 6 and urge members to support my amendments in this group. The bill enables groups of companies to register collectively for Scottish aggregates tax and sets out how groups of companies and members of such groups are to be treated with regard to tax liabilities and administrative processes. On Amendment 6, Section 30 of the Bill establishes that where bodies corporate are treated as members of a group for the purposes of Scottish aggregates tax, and one of them subsequently becomes no longer eligible for group treatment, that body is under a duty to notify Revenue Scotland of that fact. Amendment 6 clarifies that this notification must be made immediately upon eligibility ceasing. This provides certainty about the timing of notification and avoids any dispute should a related penalty be issued by Revenue Scotland. Amendment 7 inserts a requirement that a person or body which becomes aware of any inaccuracy in an application or notification regarding group treatment must notify Revenue Scotland immediately of that. Amendment 13 creates a corresponding penalty of £250 for failing to do so. This matches the existing provision and penalty for the UK aggregates levy and is intended to encourage inaccuracies to be brought to the attention of Revenue Scotland. Thank you.
Okay, no members have indicated they wish to come in. Minister, to wind up.
No further comment, Convener.
Okay, the question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Members have indicated their agreement to both. Call Amendment 7 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 6. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that Sections 31 to 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Members have indicated agreement. I call Amendment 8 in the name of the Minister, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Minister, to move Amendment 8 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I move Amendment 8 in my name and I urge members to support my amendments in this group. The amendments in this group refine and add to the penalties relating to Scottish aggregates tax in Part 1 of the Bill. They integrate the penalties fully into the established devolved taxes penalty system and ensure consistency of approach with other fully devolved taxes. Taxpayers are required by Section 19 of the Bill to notify Revenue Scotland when they cease to carry out any taxable activity so that they can be deregistered. Amendment 8 removes the penalty for failing to comply with this requirement. On reflection, I do not consider a penalty is required here as there is no advantage to the taxpayer in remaining registered and they will have to continue to fulfil all their obligations until they are deregistered. On Amendment 9, Section 211 of the Revenue Scotland and Taxpayers Act provides that the amount of certain penalties is to be reduced by the amount of any other penalty if it is applied and determined by reference to the same tax liability. This amendment adds a penalty for failure to notify of exempt aggregate production to the penalties eligible for a reduction of this kind. Section 20 of the bill requires taxpayers to notify Revenue Scotland of the production of specified types of exempt aggregate and to keep required records in support of this notification. Amendment 10 creates a penalty for failing to keep the records as required, and this penalty is necessary to ensure that record-keeping requirements are complied with. Amendment 12 makes a consequential change to Section 44 of the bill. Amendment 11 removes the penalty included in the bill at introduction for providing inaccurate documents in support of tax credit claims. Having taken into consideration the evidence provided during Stage 1 and further engagement with Revenue Scotland, I am now satisfied that this penalty duplicates powers already available to Revenue Scotland and should be removed to avoid confusion. Amendment 14 makes a minor change consequential to that removal. For specified penalties, Revenue Scotland or a tax tribunal can accept that there is a reasonable excuse for failing to comply with a statutory requirement. In such cases, there can be no liability to a penalty arise. Amendments 15 and 16 apply the provision on reasonable excuse to the new penalties for failing to notify Revenue Scotland of exempt aggregate production and for failing to notify a change to group treatment. Finally, Amendment 17 relates to all the new penalties for Scottish aggregates tax and specifies rules relating to the payment of the penalties and to their assessment by Revenue Scotland. This amendment is intended to ensure that there are clear and consistent rules for all the new penalties. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. No members have indicated they wish to speak, so Minister, to wind up.
No further comments.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 9 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 8. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 42 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 10 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 9. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Call Amendment 11 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 8. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
Then the question is that Amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 43 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 12 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 8. Minister, move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 44 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 45 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 13 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 6. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 46 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Call Amendments 14, 15, 16 and 17, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 14 to 17 on block.
Moved.
And does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 14 to 17? The question, therefore, is that Amendments 14 to 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that Section 47 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Sections 48 to 51 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 18 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendment 30. Minister, to move Amendment 18 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Convener, I move Amendment 18 in my name and urge members to support it. The Revenue Scotland and Taxpayers Act provides that a taxpayer may make a claim for a repayment of tax up to 5 years after the relevant tax return. Section 52 in this bill provides that a repayment of a claim can be refused in circumstances where a taxpayer has another amount of tax outstanding. This could relate to an undisputed amount of tax, amount of tax due after a review or appeal, or a failure to postpone payment in a review or appeal context. It adds to an existing list of circumstances as set out in Section 113 of the Revenue Scotland Taxpayers Act. Amendment 18 addresses a potential point of confusion raised during Stage 1. It provides, as intended, that Section 52 can be used where a taxpayer has a debit and a credit for the same devolved tax, as well as situations involving two different devolved taxes. I would therefore urge members to support Amendment 18. Amendment 30 from Liz Smith has a much more fundamental impact on Section 52. It would prevent Revenue Scotland from refusing a repayment claim where the taxpayer is disputing other outstanding debts through a review or appeal. The Scottish Government's position is, however, that in the case of a live appeal on the other amount owed by the taxpayer, Section 52, as amended by Amendment 18, is consistent with broader provisions in the Revenue Scotland Taxpayers Act and should not be amended in this way. Specifically, Section 245 of the Revenue Scotland Taxpayers Act provides for the important principle that where there is a review or appeal, any tax charged, penalty or interest imposed remains due and payable as if there had been no review or appeal. The Scottish Government's view is that as Amendment 30 delays the time frame during which Section 52 could be used, it undermines this principle. We will come to discuss set-off provisions in the next grouping, but for clarity, any repayment would not be automatically set off against tax due while there was a dispute. The proposed arrangements would, however, preserve the status quo until the appeal was resolved. If the amount owed by the taxpayer is extinguished in an appeal, Section 52 would cease to be relevant and the repayment claim would be considered against the other grounds in Section 113 of the Revenue Scotland Taxpayers Act. If the amount owed by the taxpayer was upheld on appeal, then any set-off would be regulated by Section 56. Revenue Scotland would provide guidance on the detail of this. Overall, the Scottish Government's view is that Section 52, as amended by my Amendment 18, would be more consistent with the existing legislation and would strike a better balance between protection of the taxpayer and protection of public revenues. And for those reasons, I would ask members not to support Amendment 30.
Thank you very much. Liz Smith to speak to Amendment 30 and the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, and thank you, Minister, for explaining regarding Amendment 18. As the Minister will be aware, the concerns that I have submitted in the Amendment 30 were raised by the Law Society of Scotland, who felt that there wasn't sufficient safeguards in the bill for taxpayers to address a situation where there is a dispute between a taxpayer and Revenue Scotland about the amount of any tax that's outstanding. So that's the reason for my submission of that amendment. And I think it's really in line with the committee's desire over a whole lot of range of taxation to be as transparent as we possibly can be. As the Minister will know, the Law Society considered that the bill should make clear that the set-off powers, as the Minister has referred to, would not apply when there is a dispute over the relevant tax amounts. So that's the reason for amendments in sections 52 and 56 as they relate to that. I've listened carefully to what the Minister has said, as I say, with regard to his Amendment 18, but I think we just welcome a little bit of clarity about exactly why that Amendment 18 will cover the points that the Law Society have raised.
Hold on, before I let the Minister in, just anyone else want to comment? Minister, to respond.
Well, first of all, I'd say that Amendment 18 is round about the making sure that situations involve two different devolved taxes are within the scope, which was a clarification on the intent of the legislation to close that particular loophole, if you will. Clearly, set-off we're going to come on and discuss in the next group in more detail, and I know that Liz Smith has an amendment with regards to that as well. I think the important point here is that there are safeguards, obviously, for the taxpayer. That's where the key concern is, round about the ability to appeal and the review processes, which provides that safeguard, and I think to maintain consistency with the legislation as it works at the moment, including that important principle that tax remains due until such times as the review process has been completed. That is important to maintain consistency with the legislation as it is in place at the moment.
Liz?
Yeah. Thank you. I understand the issue about consistency. I think that's important. I think the Law Society's concern is about the safeguards for taxpayers. We will come not just to my further amendment, but to Mr. Mason's one about the consistency with other devolved powers later. But I think it's on this point they are really seeking that safeguard. But if the Minister can provide that assurance that his amendment will provide that transparency and safeguard, then I'm willing to remove that.
Yeah, so I think that this preserves my, the situation as is without listening to Amendment 30 preserves the situation where the status quo applies, so nothing is taken forward in regards of the situation until the appeal is resolved. Amendment 22 that comes up in the next group, I think, perhaps provides the reassurance that Liz Smith is seeking roundabout. And I think Revenue Scotland and Evidence gave commitments on that, and it's to put that into the legislation that the set-off isn't applied until such time as any dispute that may be in play regards to a debit, in regards to money owed potentially by a taxpayer to Revenue Scotland, until that appeal process is resolved and clarifies the point that I meant, that set-off wouldn't take place until that happens. So I think Amendment 22 in the next group perhaps provides the reassurance that Liz Smith is seeking.
Okay, Minister, to wind up.
I think I've covered all the points, thank you.
Okay, that's fine. Okay, the question is that Amendment 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 13, name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 18. Liz Smith to move or not to move?
Not moved.
The question is that Amendment... okay, so the question is that Section 52 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 53 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are.
I
call Amendment 19 in the name of the Minister, group with Amendment 20. Minister to move 19 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Convener, I move Amendment 19 in my name and urge members to support my amendments in this group. Consultation is one of the four pillars of the Scottish approach to tax policy and is key to ensure legislation is fit for purpose. I know that the fact that the provisions in Part 2 of the Bill were not consulted on was discussed at length during Stage 1. But it has always been our intention that a full public consultation would be undertaken before any secondary legislation was introduced. This would be wide-ranging, focusing on both policy and operational considerations relevant to the enabling powers. I've heard the calls for this commitment to be stated explicitly on the face of the bill from the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee and others, and that is why I'm pleased to bring forward Amendments 19 and 20. Amendment 19 amends Section 54 of the Bill, which gives ministers a power to make regulations about communications from Revenue Scotland to taxpayers, including provision about the use of electronic communications. Taking a regulation-making power here will allow detailed consideration and engagement and allow updates as technology develops to provide clarity and certainty to taxpayers. So it makes good sense to have a requirement for consultation on the face of the Bill. Amendment 20 amends Section 54 of the Bill, which gives ministers a power to make regulation relating to Revenue Scotland's use of automation. This enabling power is intended to enable Revenue Scotland to automate those decisions which do not require an exercise of discretion or judgment. One such example of this would be Revenue Scotland's function to assess and notify a penalty where a land and buildings transaction tax return is late. I am conscious that while the use of digital systems is growing in all parts of life, it is essential that those who cannot use such systems are not excluded. For this reason, the Scottish Government has always been clear that we will undertake thorough consultation prior to the introduction of this secondary legislation. However, as with Amendment 19, I hope that by putting a requirement to do so on the face of the bill, I'm able to offer reassurance to those MSPs and stakeholders who have expressed concerns. Thank you.
Thank you, Liz.
Thank you, and I'm pleased to hear the Minister acknowledging that part two of the bill, that we had quite a lot of issues about lack of consultation, and I think that's the same point that's been raised by some other stakeholders, and I'm sure Mr Mason will speak more to that when he deals with his own amendments. But I think it is critical, Minister, that there is proper consultation. It's the same issue that I received comment on from the Law Society about this, and I think it's good to see that amendment that you've submitted regarding increased consultation, because I think it's very important that we do keep that on time. And I think, you know, just to put on record, I think one of the issues about this whole bill is not that anybody is objecting in principle, it's the fact that there's a lot of lack of data to underpin the amount of revenue and the behavioural change that will emanate from that, and that makes it quite difficult to, you know, scrutinise. So I think that's an important guarantee that you've given, Minister, in order to enhance the scrutiny and to ensure that we can track what's happening with the bill.
Okay, Minister, to respond and wind up.
Yeah, I thank Liz Smith for the points she raised, very important points, and thank her for welcoming those amendments 19 and 20. And I think that's the crux of it. The the need for consultation is critically important. The lack of data has been recognised, obviously, including in the stage one debate and in the committee, and recognise that. And as more data becomes available moving forward, that using that to help inform developments and having the consultation provisions in place on the bill is important to allow that to happen effectively.
Okay, the question is that Amendment 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that Section 54 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 20 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 19. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 55 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I call Amendment 21 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 22, 31, 23, 24 and 25. Minister to move Amendment 21 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, I move Amendment 21 and ask members to support my amendments in this group. The bill introduces the ability for Revenue Scotland to set off taxpayer credits against taxpayer debits. This is an administrative process aimed at streamlining the payment of tax and reducing the number of unnecessary transactions required for both Revenue Scotland and for the taxpayer. This will support the efficient and effective administration of the devolved taxes. I would note that this power is particularly appropriate in a self-assessed tax system like Scotland's. The majority of the time, taxpayers will declare how much tax they owe to Revenue Scotland. There will, however, be occasions when either the taxpayer needs to amend the amount that they have declared or Revenue Scotland question the declared or paid tax. Revenue Scotland stated at committee that set-off would not be used where the amounts in issue are disputed. In such cases, taxpayers' interests are safeguarded. That's why I've introduced Amendment 22, which clarifies that set-off will not be used if the sum due by the taxpayer can be varied or set aside on review or appeal. I hope that this offers reassurance to stakeholders and members who raise concerns regarding Section 56 of the bill during Stage 1. As with Section 52 of the bill, I am conscious of the need to look at Section 56 in the context of the Revenue Scotland and Taxpayers Act, 2014 Act. The Act contains a number of different definitions and processes for the management of devolved taxes, and there is a danger of amendments having unintended consequences for other parts of the Act. It is on that basis that I cannot support Amendment 31 from Liz Smith. It infers an equivalence between credits, which are sums payable by Revenue Scotland to a taxpayer, and debits, which are sums payable by a taxpayer to Revenue Scotland. Debits arise either by the taxpayer having self-assessed their liability or by a decision made by Revenue Scotland. Rights of review and appeal exist for the taxpayer in respect of the latter. Credits may follow from reviews or appeals finding in favour of the taxpayer or by Revenue Scotland agreeing a repayment claim, or they may arise from an amendment of a tax return. But existing provisions regulate credits in these situations, and there is a risk of this amendment creating inadvertent change in legal uncertainty. Making the requirement to pay credits subject to review or appeal could also operate to the detriment of a taxpayer if, for instance, the taxpayer was incurring interest charges on a debit. If the goal, which is a laudable one, is to protect the taxpayer, then it's only the definition of debit in Section 52 that needs to be adjusted here. And for those reasons, I ask the committee not to support Amendment 31 and instead support my Amendment 22. Lastly, in this group, Amendment 24 provides that the set-off provisions may not be used to set a post-insolvency credit against a pre-insolvency debit. This ensures that Revenue Scotland will not be unfairly disadvantaged, unfairly advantaged in insolvency provisions, and that the normal rules of insolvency will apply. Amendments 21, 23 and 25 are minor and consequential to Amendment 24. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much, Minister. Liz Smith to speak to Amendment 31 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, and I submitted this on the same basis as the previous one, just to enhance transparency, but the Minister has effectively spoken with his Amendment 22, which I think clarifies the situation. And I do understand the need for consistency with the 2014 Act, so that's helpful.
Okay, thank you very much for that. No one else wants to contribute to this debate? So, Minister, to wind up?
No further comments.
Okay. The question is that Amendment 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Call Amendment 22 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 21.
Yes.
The question is that Amendment 22 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Call Amendment 31 in the name of Liz Smith. Already debated with Amendment 21. Liz Smith to move or not move?
No, not moved.
The question is that Amendment 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Sorry, I moved on to Amendment 31 be agreed to. Sorry, that's said. Okay. I moved a bit too quickly because you said not moved. I just moved on to Amendment 31. Sorry. Okay, so that's not been moved. So the question is, if Amendment 31 be agreed to, are we all agreed?
Not moving 31. I think you're one line down.
Oh, sorry. You're right. Aye, indeed. Good. Apologies for that. I call Amendment 23 in the name of the Minister already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is Amendment 23 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. Call Amendment 24 in the name of the Minister already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is Amendment 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is at Section 56 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. Call Amendment 25, name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 25 agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that Section 57 agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. Call Amendment 32 in the name of John Mason, grouped with Amendments 32, 34 and 35. John Mason to move Amendment 32 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Right, thank you very much, convener. And I think, as the Minister's already said, and as Liz Smith referred to, that there was no consultation on part two. And I think certainly the Law Society, who have proposed all of these amendments, had these ready to go. And but because there hadn't been consultation, they hadn't had the opportunity to put them in. And so they came along and suggested them at stage two. So that's broadly why these four amendments are there. I'll come back to 32 later if that's okay, but if I can start with 33, which is perhaps the most straightforward. This amendment means that the provisions inserted by the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Group Relief Modification Scotland Order 2018 apply to chargeable transaction in respect of which the effective date is on or after the 1st of April 2015. The amendments to the original 2013 Act by the 2018 order were intended to make it clear that the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Group Relief would be available where Scottish share pledges were in place. But the amended provisions applied to chargeable transactions after 30th June 2018 and could not be made retrospective to 2015. I think at the time the government did accept this and did say that they would introduce legislation at an appropriate time in the future date. However, that is now 6 years ago. So I think the argument is that that this has broadly been agreed to, and it's just a question of whether this is the appropriate bill to bring this in or whether it should be somewhere else. And if I can just say at this point, I think this does highlight a point that Liz Smith has made many times, that we need some kind of mechanism for these relatively minor adjustments to existing tax legislation, which you probably would not want a whole bill just for something like this. And so this has been, or seems to be, the first opportunity to make this amendment. Hopefully the government will be willing to accept it. And I think it, again, it emphasises this question of should we have an annual or maybe a every couple of years a finance bill for this kind of thing. So the date of 1st April 2015 was the commencement date of Schedule 10 of the LBTT Act. So this change would be, I understand, of great assistance to taxpayers who entered into chargeable transactions before 30th June 2018, looked to claim group relief, but where share pledges were in place so that, in fact, group relief was not available. The point arises in practice, for example, in due diligence reviews carried out in advance of purchase transactions and would provide welcome legal clarity. Amendment 34, also in my name, does get a little bit complex, and I am not a lawyer, but I will do my best. The aim of this amendment is to make clear that LBTT group relief is available on the transfer of a property to a company as part of a non-partition demerger. which I had to look up, I have to say, where stamp duty relief under Section 75 of the Finance Act 1986 is available on the subsequent transfer of the demerged company. I think the kind of overall point of this amendment is that LBTT has got out of line with what was intended under SDLT, and the question is whether that is intentional or whether that is not intentional. Obviously, if it's intentional, that's okay. But I think that the assumption of the Law Society is that it is unintentional. But the Minister will obviously comment on that. LBTT group relief is currently not available in these type of non-partition demergers, i.e. demergers where the same parties own both parts of the demerged business following the demerger. This is because paragraph 5B of Schedule 10 of the LBTT 2013 Act, it provides that group relief is not available in a transaction where the seller and the buyer are to cease to be members of the same group by reason of the buyer ceasing to be a subsidiary of the seller or a third company. I will not quote you the Act. Paragraph 3 of Schedule 10 provides that LBTT group relief is not available if the effective date of the transaction there are arrangements in existence by virtue of which at that or some later time a person has or could obtain control of the buyer but not of the seller. However, paragraph 3 of Schedule 10 is modified by paragraph 4, which provides that it does not apply to arrangements to which paragraph 9, 10 or 10A applies. The effect of this is a capital reduction demerger where property is transferred into a company which is then demerged. Group relief on that transfer is not blocked by paragraph 3, provided that stamp duty section 75 relief is available on the subsequent demerger of the company to which the property is transferred. There's no similar modification to paragraph 5B, so as currently drafted, LBTT group relief is not available in a non-partition demerger, even though stamp duty section 75 relief is available on the transfer of the demerged company. And as I said before, I think the question was this intentional or was this not intentional? There's a similar issue in relation to the drafting of provisions of stamp duty, land tax, group relief in Schedule 7 of the Finance Act 2003. Paragraph 2.1 is the equivalent to paragraph 3 of Schedule 10 for LBTT. It denies group relief if there is a change in control. Paragraph 2.1A(b)(c) contains an exception where the arrangements are entered into with a view to a reconstruction, where stamp duty reconstruction relief under Finance Act 1986, Section 75 is available. Paragraph 22B of Schedule 7 is the SDLT equivalent to paragraph 5B of Schedule 10 for LBTT. As with LBTT, there is no similar carve-out of Finance Act 1986, Section 75 relief transactions. However, the accepted view is that it is implicit in the SDLT legislation that the exception to the change of control provisions for Finance Act 1986, Section 75 transactions also applies to the degrouping provisions in paragraph 22B. Otherwise, there'd be no point in the exception to subparagraph 1 of paragraph 2, as it would always be overridden by paragraph 22B. Now, I think this is quite an important point, that this is covered in the guidance or the manual from HMRC concerning SDLT. And Revenue Scotland has indicated that it would not be possible for it to issue guidance equivalent to the guidance issued by HMRC. Now, I have to say, I was uncertain about that point and questioned it with the Law Society, but I think this came up at stage one, actually, that Revenue Scotland consider that they cannot issue this kind of guidance because they don't have the legal powers to, and perhaps that's a point that the Minister could comment on. The effect of the proposed amendment is to amend LBTT group relief legislation to make it clear that paragraph 5B of Schedule 10 does not deny LBTT group relief on the transfer of property to a company which is subsequently demerged in arrangements where Finance Act 1986 Section 75 relief is available. Hopefully, it's getting dark. My apologies for this. Right, the final of these three, 35, is slightly more straightforward, I think. The example is that where A contracts to sell land to B, and before that contract has completed, B contracts to sell that land to C, B can claim land and buildings transaction tax subsale development relief under Section 10A of the LBTT 2013 Act, provided various conditions are met. One condition is that the significant development for commercial purposes of the subject matter of the qualifying subsale will be completed within the relevant period. The relevant period is defined in Schedule 10A, paragraph 4.3, as the period of 5 years from the date on which the first buyer entered into the qualifying subsale. The current drafting of paragraph 4.3 means that the end purchaser C has to complete significant development within 5 years of entering into a contract to purchase the land, not within 5 years of that purchase being completed. In practice, development cannot start until C owns the land, as C could not start development on the land which it did not own. The amendment therefore changes the definition of the relevant period so that the period of 5 years commences when C acquires the land rather than from the date B contracts to sell the land to C. I hope that is all clear to members. And finally, just moving back to 32, there was some debate as to whether 33, 34, 35 were going to be admissible given the range of the Act of the Bill, and the convener ruled that they were admissible. So therefore 32 was only to, as a kind of cover or fallback position in case the government would not accept 33 or 34 or 35. So if the government is willing to accept any of them, I would not be moving. I would seek to withdraw 32. Thank you for your indulgence.
Thank you very much. It's all very obvious and straightforward. I would have thought, Minister, but if you wish to respond.
Indeed, thank you very much. And thank you to John Mason for bringing forward these amendments. As the committee will know, it's standard practice for the Scottish Government to review all legislation to ensure it remains fit for purpose as part of our day-to-day policy development, and this is very much the case for tax legislation too. Revenue Scotland is fully engaged in this process, offering its operational expertise of devolved tax administration. The Part 2 provisions in this bill relate to the Revenue Scotland Tax Powers Act 2014, take account of this ongoing process. And the Scottish Government also recently brought forward a series of amendments to the LBTT Additional Dwelling Supplement following a detailed review. In previous years, various SSIs have been introduced to Parliament which have amended the 2014 Act, Scottish Landfill Tax and LBTT legislation in response to emerging issues, tribunal decisions and relevant developments in other parts of the UK. In that context, the Scottish Government's view is that a provision on the face of the bill related to legislative review is unnecessary. Given the potential scope of the amendment, a one-year time period is also considered unrealistic and would not result in meaningful review in practice. I would, however, wish to explore this further with the member and indeed with the committee in particular to understand whether there are specific issues that he would like to see prioritised as part of the Scottish Government's ongoing commitment to review. The Scottish Government is also giving careful consideration to the possibility of making more formal commitments to legislative review as part of its proposed tax strategy. And for those reasons, I would ask John Mason not to press Amendment 32 for the moment. Turning to Amendments 33, 34 and 35, which introduce amendments to the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Scotland Act and relate to specific issues raised by stakeholders during the Stage 1 process. And Mr Mason has comprehensively and thoroughly explained the details of the issues being considered here, so that I don't have to. Amendment 33 would provide a retrospective effect for a 2018 change to LBTT group relief introduced by SSI. I recognise that this reflects a ministerial commitment made by a previous administration and that a change can only be made through primary legislation. On the basis of that prior commitment, and as this is purely an administrative matter with no implications for future tax revenues, I am content to support this Amendment 33. Amendment 34 provides for group relief to be available in LBTT in instances of non-partition demergers. I am sympathetic to the case for change, but given the complex, as we've witnessed, nature of this subject, I would wish to ensure that there is time properly consider the wording of any amendment. This is to ensure that it does not introduce any unintended consequences to the legislation. As such, I would invite John Mason not to press this amendment now to allow for further consideration and engagement on the detail in advance of Stage 3, and I'm very keen to work with him on that any potential amendment. And finally, Amendment 35 is intended to provide absolute clarity on the timelines applying to LBTT subsoil development relief. And again, I'm sympathetic, in particular, as the intended effect appears to be in line with the policy intent for LBTT in this area and the current Revenue Scotland guidance. And I would, of course, wish to ensure that the wording of any amendment does not create any unintended consequences or other issues. So likewise here, I would invite John Mason not to press this amendment now to allow for further engagement in advance of any amendments being brought forward at stage three. Thank you.
Thank you very much. John Mason, to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 32.
Thank you. I thought the other members would all want to take part in this debate, but there we go. So I very much welcome the Minister's comments and commitment, which is extremely positive, so I'm pleased about that. The point about, well, 33 he's accepting, 34 and 35 is sympathetic but wants time to consider, which is fair enough, and hopefully we can come back to that at stage three. So given that, as I said already, that 32 was only a kind of fallback position, and so I would seek to withdraw 32.
Do any members object to the withdrawal of Amendment 32? No members have objected. I call Amendment 33 in the name of John Mason, already debated with Amendment 32. John Mason to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 34 in the name of John Mason, already debated with Amendment 32. John Mason to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 35 in the name of John Mason, already debated with Amendment 32. John Mason to move or not move?
Not moved.
The question is Amendment, call Amendment 26 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 27, 28 and 29. The Minister to move Amendment 26 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, I move Amendment 26 in my name and I urge members to support my amendments in this group. These amendments make changes to make changes in response to the Stage 1 scrutiny of the Bill by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. Section 4 of the Bill defines accepted processes, the products of which are not considered to be aggregates for the purposes of Scottish Aggregates Tax. Included as an exempt process is any process by which a relevant substance is extracted or otherwise separated from aggregate. The Bill sets out a list of relevant substances, generally industrial minerals, not used for aggregate purposes. Section 4.4 of the Bill provides Scottish Ministers with a regulation-making power to allow Scottish Ministers to add or remove a substance from the list. Amendments 26 and 29 make the use of this power subject to affirmative procedure as recommended by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. Section 12 of the Bill provides Scottish Ministers with the power to set the rate or rates of Scottish aggregates tax by regulations. The Bill at introduction specifies that use of this power should be subject to the made affirmative procedure in Parliament. As recommended by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, Amendments 27 and 28 make the first use of this power subject to the ordinary affirmative procedure, while subsequent regulations will remain subject to the made affirmative procedure. This is consistent with the approach taken for Scottish landfill tax. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. No members have indicated that they wish to contribute to the debate. The question is that Amendment 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendments 27, 28 and 29, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 27 to 29 en bloc.
Moved.
Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 27 to 29? No member objects. The question is that Amendments 27 to 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that Section 58 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Sections 59 to 62 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That ends Stage 2 consideration of the Bill. So I want to thank the Minister for his contribution and those of colleagues. So that's concluded the deliberations with regard to devolved tax administrations of Scotland Bill Stage 2 and the public part of today's meeting. We now move into a private session, so I'll just allow a couple of minutes for the official report and broadcasting to leave.